but I'm not going to talk. I keep talking to people and they think they need to stop living. Sarah, I'll just hear yourself, so I'll let you.
And sorry, I am going to read because I can't retain certain amounts of information in my head. I would actually like to begin by paying my respects to the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation as traditional custodians of the land on which this event is taking place. I would also like to acknowledge the Kabi Kabi people as the traditional owners of the place on which I work and reside, and say thank you for the deep respect and caring of the country you bestowed upon the land. We have much to learn from this deep understanding and limited time to make changes to our current unsustainable relationship with the environment. So I'd like to welcome you to Distance of a Whisper. My sincere thanks to all of you for being here today and for your interest in my arts practice. Thank you, Sally, and your wonderful team, Kristen and Micah. I'm going to have a blank here. For your ongoing support and encouragement and for the opportunity to exhibit in this fabulous space. Also, thank you to my family, my darling husband, Jeff, my beautiful sister, Donna, brother-in-law Nick, who have come especially today. And to my darling friends, I've had so many surprises today. Sophie and Stephanie and Paula and Daniel. Thank you, what a surprise. Your ongoing love and support means so much to me and I am so grateful. This body of work, undertaken over the greater part of the last 12 months, looks specifically at time and place, and represents my observations of native plant reproductive organs at varying stages of development in multiple locations. Principally Wootha in southeast Queensland, where we reside, Kanangi in Hobart, Tasmania, and Bundanon in New South Wales. I've been documenting when and where particular native plants grow, flower, and fruit, and the conditions they need in order to do so. The complexity of this reproductive process highlights just how fragile and tenuous the balance is between human intervention and the natural world. In order to introduce you to this exhibition, I'd like to take you on a short journey. And as I do so, I would like you, the audience, to think about what you would like to know about my practice and what brings you here today. So I'm going to change the pace a little and give you some insight into the way I view and interpret the natural world around me. I'm walking. The air is fresh and fragrant. It's September, early spring, cool but muggy. Rain is brewing, mist rising through layers of green. There is the crunch of gravel underfoot as I follow a narrow, rocky path. My eyes are searching, seeking a form, a colour, pattern, a tiny glint of something special. I am the foyer. I stop to engage with musky pink flowers, clustered and sprouting from the trunk of a tree. They have forms, closed, emerging and open. I see folds and pleats, like fabric, silk satin, soft to touch. All my senses are engaged. Floral petals, bright and showy to attract attention, but not mine. Insects, birds, small mammals, the pollinators. Ripened fruits hang heavy from branches. I touch them, hold them within my fingers. Curved forms, furry, seductive, suggestive and elusive. A long undulating split down the front reveals a deep velvety crevice in which the seed once resided, now dispersed. Their absence marked by rows of burst empty capsules held within the vessel. The cycle ends, begins. I am the observer. On closer scrutiny, the reproductive organs within the bell-shaped flowers differ. Male, pistils and stamens, and female, styles, stigmas and ovaries. Most male flowers have now withered, shriveled and fallen. Their job is done. The fertilised female ovaries have begun to enlarge. When I peel away the pink satin exterior, the internal form is alien yet familiar. They are sensual forms, evoking feelings of wonder and surprise, sparking visceral sensations. I remove leaves and observe joints and junctions, peer into tiny crevices, and dissect and collect. I am the intruder. assemblages, guided by form, colour, shape and size. This organic treasure sits amongst the studio, filled with vintage wall vases, entomology pins, a stuffed whale, books on plants and bones, 13 aluminium shoehorns hung from a shelf housing scientific glass jars and tiny ceramic vessels. All these objects become translated and distilled. They are integral to my practice. I am a collector. Now the scrutiny begins, and I watch my precious bounty for days and weeks as they wither, change colour and split to reveal incredible interiors, hairy, juicy and fleshy. They speak of fragility and strength. They burst open with a snap, propelling seeds across the room. They twist and change before my eyes. They possess incredible tenacity, determination, a purpose. I am a spectator. Blobs of inert porcelain are formed into rudimentary shapes, my quick sketches, held within my fingers, I mould this incredible material to the curve of my hands. A shape, carve, roll, pierce, and caress, coaxing a form, interpretation, a translation of all I have observed. I exaggerate distinguishing features and strive to capture form and movement. I draw on all my knowledge and skills, yet in many ways I must relinquish some control to the material itself. We must work together. The process is a meditation, capturing and documenting an experience of time and place, telling a story and sharing knowledge. The making is slow, contemplative, in order to honour my subject matter. Many hours of musing are passed, thoughts, hopes and fears held within the vessels. Painstakingly dotted surfaces suggest pores and hairs, while entomology pins and the occasional thorn reference museological display, pinned and ordered. Yet they also speak of control, human intervention and the precarious relationship we have with the natural world. My choice of porcelain is a considered one. The innate qualities of the material are left to speak. White, translucent, and bone-like, simultaneously fragile, strong, and precious. I am the maker.